come on in and get a seat. It's great to have everyone today, and we're going to worship God together. We are excited to be able to do this as brothers and sisters. Want to remind everybody that we do have a mass section, which is in the back part of the auditorium over here. If you would like to keep your mask on and have some separation, this part is mask optional, but it's great to be able to praise God.
Well, I hear God singing to me.
Every nation must be saved.
Well, I hear God singing to me.
Every challenge must be prayed. Sing for Jesus' sake. I hear God sing for Jesus' sake.
I hear God sing to me. I hear God sing to me. I hear God sing to me. I hear God sing to me.
I hear God singing and rejoicing, and I love my Father's song. I hear God singing and He sang. Everyone should sing.
Good morning. Let's welcome Ross and Kim McKenzie, one of our elders here.
Yes, welcome. Welcome to church. Good morning. Welcome to the North River Church of Christ. We're glad to be here together. And whether you're here in person, still trying to find a place to sit, online perhaps, we're glad you're here with us. And it's going to be a great opportunity to worship and celebrate today what God has done. We, you know, that song said, we hear God singing to us. He also hears us sing to him. Amen. Thus, the blessing and benefit and joy of collective worship and how wonderful it is. And if you're in a small group right now with 5 or 10 people, get rid of the distractions. If you're in this room with hundreds of people, let's focus in on realizing that God hears us sing to him. We're going to have some other amazing songs: Amazing Grace, Precious Lord, Oh Lord, Our Lord. It's going to be a wonderful time of worship today together. You know, one of my favorite parts of that last song was planting Christ in every nation as our great crusade succeeds. And God has done that, continues to do that. He also plants himself in our hearts individually when we allow him to do so. And that is a very encouraging thing. You know, North River was a church planting at one point when we started in 2005 with about 60 families. And we've had the privilege and the honor, haven't we, to not only serve personally as an elder all that time, but all of us, to those who've been here a short time or a long time, to see what God has done and continues to do. And I'll mention in just a minute that we're going to be, I want to talk about the fellow that preached our first sermon for us in 2005. Kim, you want to share?
Well, this is still a season of Thanksgiving, and I think it's only right and fitting, you know, to look back and to thank the people who helped us with our faith formation in the early days. And quite a few of those people are here today, honestly. And so I'm really grateful even that Sam and Jerry Lang are here. And I know we'll talk a lot more about him and about them, but just precious memories is what I have of the early years when we were a young married college students. We were met on campus, reached out to, someone studied the Bible with us, and then, you know, the formation of faith really started in a wonderful way in our lives as we were taught deep, deep spiritual truths from the Bible, you know. And I have so many memories. It's going to be emotional, but it's going to be incredible also. And I think all of us need to go back and say thank you to the people that helped us, to the people that really cemented, you know, what we were reading in God's Word in our lives, and helped us to make it through a lifetime of faith and not just a short time.
Thank you, Kim. I couldn't agree more that it is healthy for us to admire, respect, imitate, honor, and be humble enough to follow other people as they follow Christ. 1 Corinthians 11:1, and read the context before and after, but Paul calls that church to follow his example, to imitate him as he imitates Christ. And we all have benefited from having people like that in our life. And I encourage you as one of your elders to be humble enough to do that even going forward. The as I mentioned, I've not always been an elder, a parent, or a grandparent, but it seems like the time has gone by pretty quickly, right? But since that inaugural service, a lot of good things have happened. And I wanted to share briefly just how significant it was, that first service. I happen to have journals going back to 1999. This one's from 2005. Sam came and spoke to us. There was about 300 of us. We had a contribution of 9,000. We were meeting in a synagogue in East Cobb, for context. And the points were, we need to wait, which means to pray, and pray with a heart of surrender. That there's a need to worship. That when the New Testament church worships, there's a feeling of awe. And then the third was to witness, that Christ must witness through us to others. And certainly God has done that, and that was our hope and prayer in our inaugural service in 2005. Sam, thank you for being a pioneer in encouraging us to reach college students. Been a lot of college students reached then and now. We'll hear more about that later in the service. But for me personally, it is wonderful to have such a great example and an early influence of daily spiritual living. And just to enjoy being a Christian, to create a functional spiritual family. We watched you and others, and from what I'm told, it's pretty functional. And but the formative years, as Kim said, are very, very important as we pursue, imitate, admire. I know we're not too comfortable with honoring. It's probably not in our culture or our DNA, but it is in the Bible. And we do mostly honor Christ today and what he's done in our lives. And obviously, that's what the worship today is all about. And I'm going to lead us in a prayer right now. Dear God, we're just so amazed that you've chosen us in Jesus Christ to be your children. God, and you've redeemed us from empty ways of life and given us an eternal security, a spiritual purpose, friends for life, early mentors, friends to walk along the path now. God, and we're just grateful for what you've done then and now, what you've done in congregations before North River and what you'll do in the future through your people. We're grateful for the last 15 or 16 years here, and we celebrate and honor and give you praise, and we're thankful for the gathering today in person and online, and pray that the songs reach your heart. I know that they'll reach ours. Help us to engage in the worship with all of our hearts and to enjoy a day of celebration and joy together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We're going to take some time to sing this next song. It's this declaration to God how he is our good shepherd. So the Lord is my shepherd, everybody.
The Lord is my shepherd.
Understand? He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Sing defender behind me.
Defender behind me.
And I won't fear.
I won't fear.
I sing this next part. I'm filled with anointing.
I'm filled with anointing.
Thank you, Lord. And my cup's overflowing.
My cup's overflowing.
And if you believe this next part, no weapon can harm me.
No weapon can harm me.
And I won't fear.
I won't fear.
People of God, sing hallelujah. Worship Jesus right there. Now sing, he always guides me.
He always guides me.
Oh, through mountains and valleys.
Mountains and valleys.
Now sing, his joy is refreshing.
His joy is refreshing.
And that's more than just refreshes me. Sing, it restores my soul.
Restores my soul.
I sing this next part with confidence.
Yeah.
Everybody sing,
your spirit is within
so me. I'm gonna
so
walk in your peace, Jesus. Say it again, sing out
your spirit is
now say this, that's part,
my victory.
Sing my victory. Sing your spirit.
About this next verse, all that God has brought us through many dangers, toils, and snares. Come on, let's sing it out.
Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I'm in set free.
My God, He ransomed me, yeah, like a flood. His mercy reigns, and His unending love. Amazing. Let's sing an a cappella.
Set free, my God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace, unending love.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. It is great to be together here. Now is the time of our service. We remember the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Man, those two songs leading up to this time were just so moving and inspiring. I hope that you were inspired as well. If you would open your Bible to John chapter 1. You know, last week, our brother Jordan Massey did an amazing job helping us understand the why of this time. You know, how powerful the communion is. And of course, there's not a biblical mandate technically of when you should do it, the time you should do it. It's just a time that we come together as a community and have a serious celebration. Jordan highlighted a few amazing things in his message. He talked, there were so many things, but he talked about the word Eucharista. You know, that there's a level of thankfulness for this time together. And he also talked about how powerful it is that it's an identity-forming meal. 1 Peter chapter 2, that verse that talks about we're a holy nation, a royal priesthood, a people belonging to God. Once we had not received mercy, but now we receive mercy. Once we were dark, now we're light. I mean, it's just a powerful time. And then, of course, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says that Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me, and how important that is. And as we take the bread to really examine ourselves and examine our hearts. And then he reflected on Matthew 27 and he proclaimed the crucifixion. What's amazing in John chapter 1 is that John does all of this in one or two verses. He says the next day, verse 29, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. I mean, just a really powerful passage of scripture proclaiming the Lamb of God. You know, of course, in Luke 22, the passage Jordan shared, how often Jesus reminded him of the Passover, which was reflected back in Exodus. But the thing they didn't have in Exodus that we have today is we have the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God that died for our sins. Not the sins of the past, but also the present sins. So as we take our communion today, during this time, it's important for us to reflect on how far Jesus has brought us. The identity we have. The fact that we're saved. The fact that our sins are forgiven. The fact that we're thankful now. The fact that we can publicly proclaim the cross of Christ as an agent for Him, filled with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray right now. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this serious celebration. Thank you, Lord, that you have sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for us. Not only that, God, to resurrect us from our dead bodies and lift us to eternal life. God, you are precious. You are our precious Lamb. You hold us close. You've shown us amazing grace. Hallelujah for that. We thank you during this time. Thank you for his broken body. Thank you for the blood of Jesus, which washes us and cleanses us. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired.
The offering, and Kendall will come back to do that.
Kendall, that's you. I'm going to pray.
God, thank you so much for your son again, his sacrifice. And thank you, God, for the ability to give because you've given to us. I pray that our hearts are open to give and that whatever we've determined in our heart to give, we give it joyfully, all in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I think he was so taken by his wife singing there that so got to come back out. I know, right? I think we've all, can we thank Diane for that amazing rendition of Precious Lord? We got, today is a special day. We're honoring Sam and Jerry Lang. They are with us today. Can you guys go ahead and stand up so we can just see where you are? And we also have his spiritual mom back there, Ann Lucas, and Allison and Jean are all visiting here from, can you guys stand up as well? Very influential in his life. As well as many other people, we have people visiting from our sister congregations. I know the Sessions are here and some other people. I appreciate everyone being here. But we're going to do one more song before Tom comes to speak. And then we're going to have a special honoring for Sam and Jerry as part of that at the end of that. But let's all stand now. A favorite I know here, O Lord, our Lord. I get a B flat. And we're going to have the women to start us out.
O Lord, our Lord, how excellent thy name, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory
Well, it's been a very meaningful service so far, but I believe it's just going to get better and better. At 9 o'clock, we had a great gathering out in the parking lot for our 9 o'clock service, our outdoor service. Today, during this time period, starting at 11, up in our lighthouse, all of our middle school students, our high school students, their parents, probably about 150 of them, are also gathered up there and worshiping and serving. But we passed the word around at both our 9 o'clock service and at the service up the hill that we think everybody should go back and be able to spend some time this week, maybe even today, in being able to see the recording of this service and the things that we're going to be doing. We're actually talking today about a single word, honor. And what the Bible tells us is that a mindset we should have, because right after this great theology in the book of Romans, the first 11 chapters, we get into chapter 12, and now we get into practical living and thinking for a disciple and a follower of Jesus. And it starts off by saying that we should be transformed in view of God's mercies by the renewing of our mind. And so what we think about, what we focus on is so essential, and then the whole chapter is talking about life now, not just in God's grace, but in God's spiritual family, the body of Christ. and that all of us need each other. We belong to each other. And then after it says we should be devoting ourselves to one another in love, in verse 10, there's this curious phrase that we should seek to outdo one another in showing honor. Now, your translation might say honor one another above ourselves. That's an interesting way to put things. And so I want to propose something for all of us this morning. And it's simply this. We should honor others, what's the word? More, not less. And to give some attention, not only to worshiping God, not only to being so thankful and appreciative for his blessings, but also to focus on honoring each other. In fact, it's pretty much the only thing in the Bible where it talks about it's okay to be in competition with each other. In competition about showing honor and respect. I hope we can talk about this a little bit more and understand it. Now, an interesting verse in chapter 13. Again, it's best if you open up your devices or your Bibles, you follow along here, and then you reflect on these things, you circle them or highlight them, make a note, and then you reflect on them in the days to come. Very interesting what the Bible tells us here. It tells us to give everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. Oh, great. There it is, black and white. If revenue, you owe somebody some money, give it to them. If respect, you owe them respect. If honor, honor. Now, let me propose something to you that I think you'll relate to. Most of us don't like to owe anybody anything. Am I right? We do not like to be indebted to other people. And then if you keep on going in Romans 13, I think the next verse will tell us that we owe each other the perpetual debt of love for one another. And that's where it talks about being devoted to one another in love, outdoing one another in showing honor, and all the rest of this chapter 12 on the way that we relate and encourage each other. But I really think that that's not a natural thing for us to like or appreciate or look forward to, owing something to somebody. Anybody ever wince along with me in the book of Philippians where Paul tells Philemon, or in the book of Philemon, where Paul tells Philemon, not to mention you owe me your very soul. That just feels a little overdone. I mean, I don't know that I really want to owe somebody, you know, my soul, but we are in debt for those who spoke the word of God to us. We're in debt to those that we're connected with in the body of Christ. We're indebted to leaders. We're indebted to each other. And it's so important to give some thought to this and think about, well, how do I do this? Well, you can do some words of encouragement, right? Fellowship helps. You can write cards. Sometimes we do Christmas cards or Thanksgiving cards. You can write a little note and to honor somebody, encourage them in that way. I think one of the great things you can do is to pray for each other, right? You guys know my tradition. When I preach on a Sunday morning, I come in here on Saturday afternoon, and I walk up and down and through these aisles because, well, I was going to say, I know where you sit. I used to know where everybody sits. Now it's crazy. Are you outdoors? Are you up the hill? Are you on live stream? Are you here? But I still got a general footprint of where you guys are. And I go up and down these aisles and I pray various things for you. Sometimes it's a focus on your health or on your faith or on your children, your adult children, other kinds of things. Yesterday, when I walked and prayed for you, many, many, many of you individually by name, I just prayed a prayer of honor and respect for you and who you are and the life you're attempting to live and the heart that you have and whatever efforts you're making to make the world a better place, to serve people and to love God, love people, and to help change the world. Yeah, we can pray for each other, right? But, you know, I think most of this, outdoing one another in showing honor, and always understand this debt of love that we owe to each other in the body of Christ, I really think most of it happens internally. It happens in our hearts. It happens in our minds. It happens the way that we view each other and think about each other when we're present or when we're not present. This idea of outdoing each other and showing honor. Now, it's a very interesting thing because there's certain categories of people that we're told to honor in a special way. Let me give you the parents' favorite verse. Honor your father and your mother in the Lord. For this is right. Is it right for children to honor and respect their parents? The good ones and the not so good ones. There's another category. Hopefully this one's easier for all of us. And it tells us, the elders. Let's pause and talk about elders for a moment. The elders in your church. The elders who direct the affairs of the church, well, are worthy of double honor. Especially those whose work is preaching and teaching. And so, wow, there's a sense like with our elders and leaders in the church, there's this sense that we should give double. Now, what does that mean? The best parking places, you know, should we usher them up here? Here, have beer. How about some coffee? You want an egg muffin? Is that what it's talking about? Send them 2 Christmas cards. Send them some money, you know, bake some cookies. What is it talking about? Well, you know what? You figure it out. Apply it. Don't blow off the scripture. They're worthy of double honor. We accept that. Now, this is very interesting to me. We got this strong tendency to do what Jesus said. As he was reflecting on life, even the way people related to him, he said, you know what? A prophet doesn't get honor in his own country. What's he talking about? Sometimes kids can take parents for granted. Sometimes parents can take kids for granted. Sometimes you can take for granted the blessings you have in your country or in your church. Sometimes you, believe it or not, you could potentially take for granted the leaders in your life that the Bible is talking about. Whether it's leaders or your family group leaders or the deacons or other people in the church, there is this tendency. You know, when they were building the wall of Jerusalem in Nehemiah's day, they were all working at the various gates where they were trying to rebuild. And it talks about rebuilding one of the gates next to the House of Heroes. Because in Jewish life, people reflected on the men and the women of the past and the leaders, and they gave them honor, and they actually had a spot where they remembered them, this House of Heroes, and it was inspiring. And you know what Hebrews chapter 11, it's this long list of these men and women of faith who occupied hearts in places like the House of Heroes. And we're told they're like a cloud of witnesses around us, cheering us on. And you gotta believe. Now let's kind of go across, you know, some geography. Let's get to Corinth, where the Greeks are, or Athens, where these guys are very intellectual, they're sophisticated, or we go over to Rome, and we got the Romans, and they're all powerful, and they're in charge of everything, and their economy runs the world. And you know they got to be thinking, why in the world do I need to think about and follow some old Jewish dudes from 1,000 years ago? Or two, what is the point of that? Do I really need to do that? Exactly. And as you go on in Hebrews chapter 3, he talks about not only reflecting, you know, all of them, he talks about remember your leaders, past and present, who spoke the word of God to you. We want to do a little pause right now and ask who that might be in your life and who presently. Well, I don't like being led. You know, that's another issue, okay? That's a study on pride and humility and other things, all right? You'll have to do some background work, you know, on that one. But he talks about consider the outcome of their life and imitate their faith. There's even when Paul talked to Corinth, he said, well, it's not just the guys in the past. You got to look among your own church and realize in your own church, there are these guys like Stephanus and Achaicus, you know, and Fortunatus. And these are people who devoted themselves to the service of the church. In our context, it would be like some of those original people at North River or many years before that went in and laid that foundation for us and helps form the blessings, you know, that we have. And he goes on and he says, I urge you to submit to those brothers and sisters and who labor at the work. They refresh my spirit. Such men deserve recognition. I'm not even sure how you feel about that in your flesh. There's a part of us that goes, I don't want, what do you mean deserve? Aren't we all just pieces of dust and little burning wicks by the fire, by the grace of God? Well, no. When people work hard in the kingdom and in your life and they serve and they pray and care about you, yeah, they actually deserve recognition. Well, what do you mean, Tom? You figure it out. How do you just give it? I think most of all in your heart and in your head and in your attitudes that will be able to come through. Can we honor people too much sometimes? What do you think? Politicians, you ever saw a politician maybe thought got a little bit too much? You know, celebrities, athletes, you know, can you do that, you know, too much? I remember I told you this, you know, earlier. I got invited to go to one of the Braves games when they were in the playoffs with the Milwaukee Brewers, and it was a key game, and the best pitcher and the closer in the entire major leagues, Darth Vader, was pitching, and Freddie Freeman got up to the plate, and he hit this towering home run over the left field, center field, you know, fence, and it won the game, and then everybody stood up in that Truist Park, and they were going, Freddie, I got caught up in it, you know. I was Freddie, you know. I want to double back on this in a minute about who are your kids' heroes? And who do you cheer for in your heart? You know, have we had times like where we lifted up people too much? I actually think so. I think there were times, I remember when Kelly and I went back in the ministry in 2001, there was kind of a tradition we had out in L.A. Every time anybody did any kind of speech, everybody stood up and clapped. I mean, it could have been great, it could have been okay. You know, but they're going to stand up and clap. That was like a tradition. And we were just not as comfortable with it. And so I would just end my sermons when I went back in the ministry by just singing, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, you know. And I would go sit down, and then we went on with the service. It was nice. I felt good about that, okay. Is there a problem with clapping? No. I hope we do some clapping today if you really want to know the truth. Are there any issues? No. But, you know, the Bible does say in when we talk about honoring one another, you know, and consider the outcome of these people's faith, these leaders. The next verse is Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. There is no contradiction between worshiping and honoring Jesus Christ, following him as Lord, and giving recognition and honor to those among us. In fact, exactly the opposite. And so this is spirit here of outdoing one another and encouraging and giving honor. A couple of years ago, we were just finishing that work on the lighthouse, you know, brothers like Tom Bogle and Ross McKenzie and Derek and Lawrence and so many others worked so hard and sacrificed in that way. We were just, it was getting close to being a reality. And I remember with one of our leadership group meetings with our elders and evangelists, I said, you know what I would love to see us do is sometime every year have a banquet, a hero's banquet, and establish a hall of heroes and just people who have really served in a wonderful way, and they've given up their lives over many decades. And we go up there, it's a nice new building. We have a meal and we honor them and we encourage them. We just hang out together and encourage somebody before they croak. You know, why don't we just think about doing that, okay? I'm sure they witness their service, you know, later on. But wouldn't that be good for all of us, all of our hearts? And, you know, we said, you know, that would be an excellent thing to be able to do. Today, at least in my mind, we got our first inductee, okay? And that's Samuel David Lang, you know? Sam and Jerry Lang, and, you know, they've been in the hall of our hearts for a long time, but we want to give them some special honor for their years of service. In the spirit of what? The Scriptures, okay? In the spirit of the Scriptures. That's what we're looking to do. We brought this up in a recent leadership group, and one of our younger leaders was in there. I won't identify them. I'm really tempted to, but I'm not going to do that. And one of our younger leaders said, "Well, why, Sam? Sam's a great guy, but we have a lot of great servants here in the church. Why don't we? What about just honoring them?" Sherman McIntyre is a good friend of mine. He's an elder. He's a very kind-hearted man. Most of the time. He looked at this young guy with a fierceness I have never personally seen before. I'm not sure if the eyes were red or not, but he looked at that guy and he had an admonishment. Let's just put it that way. Well, we decided to go ahead and have this honoring, you know, here for, you know, Sam. But seriously, why honor Sam and Jerry, you know, Lang? We've clearly, obviously honored Jesus in communion. We talked about it so much last week. We honored him today. We honor the Scriptures. We love God. But in a special way, we would like to say a few words, and we're going to do that the last part of the service. Sam, I think that for so many of us, this is why I want to really encourage our younger people to listen to this and to think about this. It's hard to overstate or quantify the impact that Sam and Jerry Lang have had on our families and in our lives. I mean, with this book that you guys wrote on raising awesome kids in a troubled world, was that prophetic or not? Talk about troubled times. And, you know, when me, Kelly, and I, when we look and we think about Sam and Jerry and their family and all their kids and their spouses and their grandkids, you know, it's just hard to express the appreciation and gratitude for the books, for the life, and your example. That's just one thing, but the churches that Sam and Jerry have helped establish and to grow, the books written, the stirring speeches. But I think for me, and for many of us, it was Sam Lang's love for the Word of God, especially the Old Testament. I mean, you name your kids, you know, David and Jonathan, you know, that's just a start. But all the teaching that you did, it was so interesting because, and your husband Chuck, you know, gave us reverence and respect for the Word of God. You do not mess with the Word of God, and a love for Jesus' church. We got that instilled in us. Sam, what you did, you gave us this heart to love the Scriptures, especially the Old Testament. Those SDC classes and so many other things. And there's this passage in 1 Samuel. Sam Lang likes that book, 1 Samuel. Spent a lot of time in it, and 2 Samuel. Just kind of drawn to it. And there's this passage where it says in chapter 3, might even have it up here, that none of Samuel's words fell to the ground. Let's see if we, let's do that one too, okay? None of his words fell to the ground. And I think that is one of the reasons why we're so indebted and we honor and respect Sam. You know, his words made a profound effect on us. I think, Sam and Jerry, you've influenced thousands of people and probably hundreds of thousands of people. We know it's God working in you and keeping you faithful and being in the body of Christ and having strong, you know, people around you. But, you know, it's been impact. I remember the beginning. It's 1969. Sam, that's when you got baptized. February, I think, right? And Jerry, you know, in August 1969. I came to that little church, 14th Street Church of Christ in Gainesville. I was an 18-year-old freshman, and I came to church. I only stayed one time because I usually went to church to our Young Life to look for good-looking girls. I saw one. It was Jerry Guba. Now, unfortunately, she was taken, but she was the prettiest girl in the church. Now, Kelly, you had not come to church yet, okay? Got that? Got that. But I didn't go back to church. I was not that interested in church. But I did get to go to some Bible studies and soul talks. And then on December 5th, which happens to be today, 1969, I got baptized into Christ and made Jesus Christ. Do not. If you're clapping, you're clapping for Sam and Jerry for reaching out to me and for God by his grace and Kelly hanging me in there. Wow. Start getting a little emotional. Okay. Yank it back in. So 52 years ago today, I got baptized into Christ as a freshman. But my formative years, they were, Sam and Jerry had such a big thing. I think one of our favorite things back then was brothers football. You know, that was one of our favorite things, you remember. Now, here's the thing, I'm going to use an example. Brothers football, you know, mirrored for me and Sam our personalities, our DNA, and our style. Okay, Sam was always precise. Beautiful plays, everything organized. And I had one gift in life, the ability to throw a 50-yard pass. That was my one athletic gift. So it was always ad lib it, go wing it, just everybody go deep. And that's how I went with life. But it was more than that. I always was trying to stretch the boundaries. And as you can, you know, will attest, you know, and Sam, I'm going over to Kelly's sorority at midnight, throwing rocks at her window because I need some help studying, you know. And Ann's husband, you know, Chuck Lucas, our minister, came over and dragged me out of that sorority, okay, because he knew I had issues from my past, okay? That's how I kind of, you know, would go about doing stuff. And in the ministry, the same way. Sam is so steadfast, wise, concerned, thoughtful, devoted, husband, father. Me, I shoot from the hip, you know? Now, I have learned some stuff through the years by following people's example. Sam, you're always open about your feelings. I hold mine close to the vest. Sam, you write books. I do stuff. You know, most of all, I think what I and, you know, most of us remember about you is your emphasis on the heart. You always told us, Proverbs 4:24, above all else, guard your heart. For from it flows the wellsprings of life. And Sam taught us about this, David, through 1 and 2 Samuel. I went to IPI, Illumination Publishers, this week, and I wanted to get a download of Sam teaching on David. For $3.99, you can get 4 lessons. I got it, and I'm going to make you an offer. If you download it and listen to all 4, come up to me and I'll give you a $5 bill. 20% handling on your part, all right? It's that good. It's that powerful. But it's about the heart, which is what really all of us need in our lives. This man after God's mind. This is what Sam taught us, you know, and opened up our eyes as we enter the Old Testament, and particularly in 1 and 2 Samuel. When you think of David, you think of his heart. Yeah, as a young guy, he was a shepherd and a poet and a songwriter, and then he killed some giants, absolutely won great victories, became a king on all of those things. But what Sam did with the scripture, reading the scripture and reading even between the lines, you learned about how do you deal with abusive leadership in the church when your discipler and leader has a contract on your life and wants to kill you. Saul, you've had some bad leaders, me too, but none that bad, you know, but the scriptures taught us how to have a heart. And what do you do when you fall off a cliff spiritually and sin horribly, stuff you never thought you would do? But to find a way back and to be repentant and to be restored, and then teaching us about, and what do you do? What do you do, David, when your kids leave the faith and you hurt and you lament, but you don't get bitter and you don't give up? This is what we learned through the scripture and through that teaching. Sam ultimately revealed to us a man after God's own heart. You helped us want to get there and to stay there. But I'd like you to hear it in Sam's own words for some of the best 90 seconds that you'll ever hear.
You know, a great heart is within reach of everybody in this room.
There's some things that are not within reach of me. The voice of the singers are not within my reach. The handsome appearance of some of the brothers here are not within my reach. Even with liposuction and surgery, I can't get there. The intelligence of Douglas Jacoby is not within my reach. I remember he and Marty Wooten were having a debate in the language of Hebrew and Greek, arguing with each other one time. Gordon Ferguson and I looked at each other and I said, "Opstay Okinte," in Pig Latin. That's the best I could do, stop talking. Amen. You know, I mean, those brains are out there. Sort of hum. You know, I'm sort of like, well, I'm opening my Bible now, I'm going to talk. There's some things just went out of my reach. The eloquence of some people is out of my reach. The spiritual power of some people, in one sense, their leadership powers are out of my reach. I want to be all I can be, but you know what is within my reach that all of us can have? We can all have a great heart. A great heart. I just want to have a great heart. I can do that. That I can do. And that means whoever I am, highest in the heavens, lowest of the lowly disciples, I can be close to God. And that's all I really care about. Then I care about that. Whether I'm obscure or well-known, I just want to have a great heart and be close to the Lord.
You can do that. I can do that.
Clapping's good. Clapping's good. I'm looking forward to visiting Sam in heaven one day. I'm pretty sure he'll have a prime spot in paradise, close to Jesus where he's always loved to be. No more tears, no more weakness, no more forgetting or regretting things. 1 Corinthians 2:9 tells us, no eye has seen, no ear heard, no mind of man has ever conceived, no matter how sharp or dull it is, has never conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Sam's heart and courage continue to help lead us. His old email was neverfear@bellsouth.com. Brother, you've always taught us like Joshua not to fear or be dismayed. Thank you for pioneering the way for us. The best is yet to come. In the meantime, as we look forward to this, the honor and immortality that we will eventually receive. In the meantime, how about we keep following Jesus, be devoted to one another in love, and let the competition begin to outdo one another in showing honor from our heart. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up.
So humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. And he will lift you up, and he will lift you up. I think it's so fitting that we honor Sam today. I honor him because as a freshman, he met me, and this was me. So I didn't look like Tom or Sam, you know, I didn't have the big physique, but I was a freshman before classes even started. I was at freshman orientation, and they had a table set up there for campus advance, and I kept circling because I was really shy. I was not going to initiate a conversation, but if somebody started talking to me, I would stop and talk. And so I kept circling the table, you know, go watch TV, come back out, they're still there, come back. But Sam eventually came over and talked to me and invited me to student supper, and I never stopped coming. And I was baptized on October 17th, 49 years ago. So I am forever indebted to you, Sam, and just grateful for that.
And Sam and Jerry, I would not be here, nor would I be married to Sherwin, nor would we have Carrie and Chase and our amazing six grandchildren. We totally owe you our souls. So how I got here is, Jerry was working at a bank in Gainesville, Florida, with my very best friend, Jean Samina, right here. And there we are. Okay, that was not when we got baptized, but we came to church, and we came on a Sunday morning, a Sunday night. We both had appointments with Sam at around 6 o'clock on a Tuesday, 2 days later. We were both baptized July 24th, 1973, around 6:30, and it stuck, and we're still here. Jean, you want to stand up? Come on. There you go. There's my best friend. So we were baptized in 1973, and this was how many years ago at the reunion? Yeah, we all went back to the Crossroads building, and there's no water in there, so we went in and got our picture taken in there. But really can't tell you guys enough all that you've meant to me personally. I really would not be here. Our families would not be here. And Jerry, you have been such an amazing just role model my whole life. I can remember different times and different aspects of my life. I remember when we first had Carrie, she was a baby, and she cried all the time. And I remember calling you up, Jerry, is she ever going to stop? And you said something like, yeah, it'll get better in about 6 weeks. I thought I was going to die. And then I also remember when I was diagnosed with cancer, Jerry was one of the first people that I called. She was very encouraging, and, you know, I think you're going to be okay, but, you know, we're all coming, having to face our mortality, and, you know, but just moments in my life that you have been there personally and that the two of you guys have been there for us is we would literally not be here, and we just love you and honor you with all of our hearts.
We're going to see a video that Chase put together. It's telling kind of the life of Sam and Jerry. But I know that many of us don't need a video. We have our own videos playing in our head. But I think a lot of us probably need to see this because to know how profoundly Sam and Jerry have affected our lives, and you may not have had the privilege to know them or to met them or be impacted by their lives, but hopefully you'll be able to find out a little bit more about them as we roll this video.
Sam Lang was baptized in 1969 in Gainesville, Florida, at the very beginning of what would become the Crossroads Church of Christ campus ministry. 3 weeks later, Sam met Jerry Guba at a campus retreat. Little did he know how that encounter would change the trajectory of his life. Sam and Jerry dated and were married in 1972. Next June, they will celebrate 50 years of marriage. After graduation from the University of Florida, Sam continued to serve and lead the campus ministry in Gainesville for a total of 13 years. During this time, Sam worked alongside Chuck Lucas and saw explosive growth in the campus ministry in Gainesville. Over 100 students were being baptized into Christ each year, and that continued to grow until there were daily baptisms, over 365 in 1 year. In addition to this phenomenal growth, over 400 men and women were trained and sent out to plant campus ministries around the country. In 1980, Sam and Jerry moved to Atlanta to lead the Lenox Church of Christ, which later became the Highlands Church of Christ, where they served for almost 7 years. Since that time, Sam and Jerry have started and/or worked with churches in Boston, South Florida, New York City, North Carolina, and Georgia. Sam has served as both an evangelist and an elder. Along the way, Sam and Jerry had 4 children, Elizabeth, David, Jonathan, and Alexandra, all of them faithful disciples of Christ and married to faithful disciples of Christ as well. Sam and Jerry have 12 grandchildren, with one on the way. They consider their family to be their greatest blessing. Sam and Jerry passed on the lessons they learned from their marriage and their expanding family, co-authoring 5 books, Raising Awesome Kids in Troubled Times, Friends and Lovers, The Essential 8 Characteristics of a Growing Marriage, The Essential 8 Characteristics of a Strong Family, and The Wonder Years, written with their daughter, Elizabeth Thompson. Jerry also wrote A Life Worth Living. Their books and teaching on marriage and family have affected thousands around the world and highlighted the importance of building strong families as our churches grow. Sam has written 8 books on spirituality and how to deepen our relationship with God. Those titles include Be Still My Soul, The Guilty Soul's Guide to Grace, The 5 Senses of Romantic Love, The 7 People Who Help You to Heaven, Free Your Mind, Mighty Man of God, and Warrior. Many of their books have been translated into other languages, including Spanish, Portuguese, French, and Russian. All of their books are available on Amazon and IPI. In addition to writing and preaching, Sam worked in many other areas of ministry. Along with Dr. Douglas Jacoby, Sam founded the Athens Institute of Ministry, or AIM, and taught there for many years. AIM provided a safe place for many to gather, learn, and grow. While leading in the South Florida ministries, Sam was also deeply involved in Caribbean missions and mentored many ministers and ministries there. Sam is always a champion of music and worship to elevate the church. He has always believed in empowering, enabling, and encouraging worship leaders and artists. From meeting and mentoring a young Sherwin McIntosh with the Crossroads Singers, to planning and speaking at major worship events, Sam has always believed in the power of music to transform our hearts. His own walk with God through daily prayer and deep Bible study has been one of his greatest inspirations. Some people may not know of the special role that Sam and Jerry played in the beginnings of North River. While Sam was serving as the evangelist for the Athens Church of Christ, he served as an advisor to the new North River leadership and helped to maintain unity through the formation of many of our sister Atlanta congregations. Sam was the guest speaker for the first service of the North River Church and continued to be a guest speaker for the first few anniversaries of the North River congregation. Many of those students that were baptized in the early days of the campus ministry in Gainesville eventually found their way to North River, including several of our elders, past and present, and over 200 of our members. These are all examples of lives that were profoundly impacted by the mentorship of Sam and Jerry Lang and are still faithful disciples of Jesus. Our very own Tom and Kelly Brown were one of the first couples to be trained and sent out from the ministry training program in Gainesville and continue that good work that Sam and Jerry helped to start. Since Sam's retirement from the ministry in 2018, Sam and Jerry now live in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, where their son, David, and his wife, Lisa, lead the Grand Strand Church. Sam and Jerry are still working to build God's kingdom in every way that they can, and their legacy lives on through their children and grandchildren. David and Lisa have a podcast called Such Things, and Sam does bi-weekly videos with David entitled Sitting with Sam. Their eldest daughter, Elizabeth, and her husband, Kevin, lead the church in Wilmington, North Carolina. Elizabeth is an acclaimed author in her own right. Her trilogy, When God Says Wait, When God Says No, and When God Says Go, have all been published by Barber Publishing. All the Feels and All the Feels for Teens are published by Tyndale. Elizabeth wrote The Tender Years with her mom, and she also has her own blog, Lizzie Life. Sam and Jerry's youngest daughter, Alexandra, and her husband, Jesse, lead the church in Charleston, South Carolina, and have a podcast, My Everyday Chaos. Their youngest son, Jonathan, and his wife, Talia, are expecting their 4th child soon, which will be Sam and Jerry's 13th grandchild. It's hard to imagine our family of churches without the influence of Sam and Jerry Lang and their ever-growing family. His emphasis on building his own family and leading the church like a family has left an indelible handprint on our hearts and on our family of churches. It is an honor for North River to recognize Sam and Jerry Lang today for a lifetime of service to God's church, and we still believe our best days are yet to come.
We could go ahead and have Sam and Jerry. Yes, let's go ahead. You guys come on up. Yes.
We're going to say what it is.
Wow.
Thank you.
Love you guys so much.
That's by the grace of God. Because I feel superior to you. It's because God was merciful to me. Straighten me out and help me.
So we have a special gift for Sam. This is for you.
This is for me. Thank you.
It's a compass. Because you've always shown us our true north, and you've been a guide to us in our lives, and we pray that you can still follow God's. It says, may this is engraving on the front. May your faith always guide you. And then inside we have a quote from Joshua: be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. To Sam Lang from the North Valley Church.
And Jerry, we have a gift for you. You don't have, oh, you do have a picture of it. It's a necklace entitled Strength. Sometimes life is just hard, but hard does not mean impossible. There will be times when you will break, but it does not mean you are broken. Find your inner strength and let it light the fire in you. Remember that you do not need a giant flame to set a fire. All you need is a tiny spark. We love you so much.
We could have the other elders and the evangelists to come up here. We're going to have a prayer, Bob.
I'm thankful for all of you.
Say, stay.
We'll go pray for you up here. Before I say a prayer, I just wanted to say that I mentioned a few weeks ago I was converted when I was down in the Air Force Base in Homestead, 1976. Men and women who had been trained by Sam and Jerry had taken their summer vacation down in Miami, and they started a Bible talk on the Air Force Base. And so indirectly, I'm their child, spiritual child. But I was in a church where the preaching was, shall we say, not as if speaking the very words of God. It was very, it was milquetoast kind of preaching. And I was hungering to hear the word of God in the way that I'd been taught in these Bible studies. And somebody handed me a cassette tape by Samuel David Lang. And the first thing I thought was, wow, this guy is passionate. But the second thing was, I'd never heard the word of God laid out with all the reason why I should have faith. The logic and the passion combined was what I needed. I needed something to hang my faith on, the reason why I believe. And so we would treasure the cassette tapes. You had cassette tapes back then. You had to hand them around. And they were, when they were Sam's cassette tapes, they were like bricks of gold. We would hand them around. They would fall apart. We learned how to fix them and tape them and splice them, but we would listen to them over and over again. And so then I moved to Gainesville, and I'd never heard Jerry, and they did a workshop together, and I heard Jerry, and I thought, okay, this is where Sam gets it from, so okay. But they have had an incredible impact in my life and in so many others. So we'd like to pray for them now, and we'll also be closing out our service soon. Father in heaven, you promised us life to the full, and you've given us that life because we have men and women that we admire and can have relationships with that have inspired us and have taught us how to do that with others. Father, how to build a church that's not an organization, it's not a corporation, it's not a program. Father, it's a family. It's people. It's people who love each other and love you and give their hearts to you. We're so thankful for this couple and what they've meant to thousands and thousands of us and many hundreds in this congregation as well. And we pray that you bless their lives incredibly and their family and continue to work through them as we go through life. And Father, I pray that what we've done today will be an example to our younger brothers and sisters. They too can have these kind of lives, and we pray that they take up the call. We pray that they have the passion. We pray that they have the fervor to do so as well. We love you, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Give one more round of applause.
We're going to close out with a song here in just a moment, but Chase has a few words.
I have a few announcements. It's such an amazing, oh, I got to give you a hug.
So thank you so much. For your preacher and your song leader, their baptisms and their wives. Amen.
We love you, Sam. Just a couple of announcements. I know it's 12:20. If you need to get your kids, please go ahead and do that. But I do want to let everyone know that summer mission trips are back. It's been a long time since we have gone on a mission trip as a church. We're going to Trinidad this summer, all right? And so more details, if you need to start saving, please go ahead and do that. First interest meeting is next Sunday after church at 12:30 in the Lighthouse. So if you want to find out more, any level of interest, please do that. I'm going to just go through these kind of quickly. COVID, obviously, still around, but our COVID task force has decided that the foyer is now mask optional. That is the only change. We got our mask section. This is mask optional. Now the foyer is mask optional as well. The Thrive Ministry has a holiday mixer coming up, December 11th, 7 to 10 p.m. It's going to be $5, only $5 on Eventbrite. You can pay there. There's dancing, holiday snacks, outdoor fire pits, games, and so much more. Also, we got Angel Tree going on. All right, so we have about 100 angels on the tree. We've had 22 purchased. Please make some kids happy. Go to the North River Sign Up Genius. There's a link on the homepage of the website. And check the email that comes out on Thursdays. You will get everything you need right there. All the info is there. Also, for Martin Luther King weekend, we would like to do a blood drive through the American Red Cross. And we need to know who is going to participate. And we have a graphic for that with a QR code that you can scan or, again, check your email, and you can take a quick one-minute survey so that we know how much interest we have so that we can know if we can do that. And then the last thing is that family worship is next Sunday. We had a date change because December's crazy. So next Sunday, a week from today, we got family worship, 10:15 in the FLC. That's all the announcements. Let's stand on up. And we're going to sing one more song, which is kind of a benediction. Is that right?
Lord bless you and keep you. We're going to do that together. We're not going to bridge the aisles quite yet, so we're still staying safe here. But let's sing it to each other, but especially today as we honor Sam and Jerry, the Lord bless you and keep you.
Mm-hmm. The Lord bless you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace.
Amen. You're dismissed. Let's outdo one another in showing honor. Oh, gosh.